Denver Guitar Studios. I mean, today we're going to be looking at this guitar, which is a vintage, the brand, Zip. And it's an extremely affordable guitar. This retails at around £100, and it looks okay. It's got an interesting pickup configuration. It's very simple. But what goes into a guitar that is this affordable? We're going to take it to bits. We're going to look at every single part of it. We're going to take some of this thick paint off and see what the construction of the guitar is like, and look at some of the tolerances in the neck pocket and bits and pieces like that, see if they've used any filler. See if this binding is binding or whether it's painted. I think it should be a really good series, and I'm looking forward to starting it. So I'm just going to move the camera and we'll get to taking it to bits. Okay, so like I said, this guitar is extremely affordable, and what we want to do is look at every part of it and try and work out where they've managed to make cost savings. Because I can tell you, I can't buy wood and hardware and electronics for the retail price of this guitar. There's no way I can get those prices down low enough. So we've got to look at all of the cost saving measures, what sort of wood it is, how the construction is, how many pieces the body is. Because the thing you've got to remember is when a guitar producer puts an opaque finish on a guitar, they can hide a multitude of sins underneath there. Especially when you have on the back and the neck of a guitar an opaque finish. So we'll take that off, we'll have a look. It's got some Wilkinson tuners, which are pretty good. I don't know if the bridge is Wilkinson or not, but we'll have a look at that. And we'll see exactly what this guitar is made of. So I'm just going to start disassembling. Okay, so at this point I think I might zoom in on this pickguard and see if we can guess if there's going to be anything underneath it or whether it's just going to be completely blank. Now I think it's probably going to be nothing there, but you never know. So there you go, that screw there, it's just spinning in its hole, which makes me think that they haven't machined the hole very well, because the thread's got nothing to bite into. Interesting. The pickguard goes underneath a neck fretboard overhang. Let's see if I can't get this to even bite a little bit. So it'll come out. There we go. And then this should be able to slide that way. Yeah, it's completely blank under, and I quite like that. Looks quite good. I think I'll take the neck off now and see if we can see what the inside of the neck pocket looks like. Again, this guitar is, I bought it second hand, but in a pretty new state, and she's never been tampered with, so this should be the first time the neck has been taken off the body.
guitar, you can see inside these pockets where the neck bushings were is just a whole load of nasty compressed paint from the paint jobs. So these holes were machined after, well, before the paint, and then they were just left. So as the bushing is pushed in there by the screw, you end up with a compression, the bushing gets dirty here, and for the overall fit and finish it's not the best. Does it affect anything in your playing or the sound? Again, probably not, but it's not the best fit and finish, and you see there's some chips coming out and that sort of stuff. So let's have a look at the front of the neck pocket. Can you hold the guitar just on the friction of the neck pocket? That's pretty impressive. That's not a bad fit. I can lift that guitar just with the tightness of the neck pocket. Let's try and take her out. I think we'll look at the underside of the neck first. So we have a shim, looks to be. Seems to just be a piece of paper that they've glued in there. No sort of marking whatsoever. Let's just turn on the light and see if we can get any better focus. And can you see those lines in the paintwork? And that's where the neck, the bottom of the neck, hasn't been flat sanded, and you can see there's actually quite a big divot or paint run around the edge there, and there's a lot of build up on the edge of the fretboard here, and as you have paint build up it's likely to chip and crack and not look particularly nice. But we'll look at the neck a bit more in detail later. Let's have a look at this neck pocket. So we have some sort of factory marking. We have an, I don't know if you can see that, let me adjust the light. Okay, so it's a little bit better there. Because we have such a soft wood, we have a divot here where that piece of paper that I think is meant to be acting as a shim to increase the neck angle has pushed the wood down. Now, I think we also have a hairline crack just here. And it's quite difficult to show you, but we'll give it a go. I'll maybe turn the camera around a little. See inside this end of the neck pocket, this is all end grain, so this is where the fibres of the woods are bunched together like a straw, and this is the end of a bunch of straws, if you imagine that. And then as they've CNC'd or routed this pocket, there's a lot of tear out, so that's where the wood fibres are damaged, because they are cutting too much at once, or because they aren't using sharp enough tooling. But what you get is all of these parts where the fibres get gripped by the tool by the router blade, and they get torn out because it's moving at such high speed. It doesn't happen on the end grain, on the edge grain, as much, but here on the end grain, you get quite a lot of it. And I suspect that here on the end grain, underneath this paint, we'll see the same all along here, and at the bottom of the guitar as well. What I'll be interested to see is the tolerance between the neck and the neck pocket when I remove some of this finish. Because when you build a guitar to have a finished neck, you need to take that into account, because the paint adds thickness. So if this was an unfinished neck or a oiled neck or something that had a light satin finish rather than this heavy metal flake thick paint, you'd expect the neck pocket, the neck to be cut smaller than the neck pocket, but not by the amount that this is. Again, I'm just going to show you that this guy is pretty good. I can pick up the body of the guitar, and it's a light guitar, but that's kind of impressive for the budget that you're spending on this guitar. But we'll do some measurements, get all that gook out of there. Now I'd be interested to see whether there's a neck angle cut in there. So we've got a 17mm depth at the bottom of the guitar, and we have an 18.35mm depth at this end of the pocket, which means that they have cut a angle into the neck pocket, which is exactly what you need for this sort of bridge. It's what you get on a Les Paul, but not on a Stratocaster. They have a flat neck pocket, there is no neck angle. So it's interesting that they cut a neck angle, but then from the factory we get a shim, which increases the neck angle. So let's move on, and we might open up the electronics cavity and have a look at some of the electrics in this guitar, and I think this is probably going to be the weakest aspect of this guitar, these electronics. The pickups themselves are Wilkinson, and Wilkinson have some fantastic stuff on the market, but I think that the jack socket and the pots, and in particular the capacitors, probably the only capacitor in here, are likely to be quite budget. We'll just look at these plastics before we look at the electronics, because I always find it interesting the amount of effort that goes into plastics for a guitar. For example, this pickguard, it's okay, but some of the edges are a little broken. They're not quite, they don't look quite right, especially up here. That's quite difficult to get focused. You see, there's just a slight, it's rounded on the chamfer, but it's pointed on the top of the pickguard. And that's a bit funny. None of these edges have had anything happen to them.
after routing, you know, what I like to do when I make a pick guard is I'll polish these, I'll take a scraper to them, make them nice and flat, and then I'll polish the edges just so they're completely flat. I mean, it's a nice enough pick guard, it's an interesting shape, and the chamfers are done fairly well, and the design is pretty good. That's not, that hole there isn't too close to the edge, so you're not, unless you really hoon on the screw when you're putting it in, you're not going to get this splitting, you'd hope. Let's have a look at this guy. Let's pop that out. So yeah, I have a chamfer on the inside, and that is because we have paint buildup. So when we spray the guitar, we have buildup inside these lines. And if this are the perfect right angles, if this was just a flat piece of plastic, it wouldn't sit properly. So they've, by the looks of it, hand chamfered these edges. There's some file marks, some tooling marks there. So yeah, so at some point it'll have been somebody's job just to sit there, and maybe with a belt sander or a file, just knock the edges of these off so that it fits in there and looks quite nice. And what's happened there is, now this is going to be quite difficult to see, but if I held a straight edge up against that line that is meant to be straight, you've actually had some damage occur on this corner. Same again over here, you've got a kind of a wobbly line on what should be a smooth curve, and that's due to the guy at the factory holding it against the sander and just, you know, turning it quite quickly, because that's his job. I mean, that's what the guy gets paid to do, really quickly get it done. Right, so let's have a look inside this cavity. So what do we have? Here's your volume, and we have our one pickup, and you can see it's not even screwed in. I can move that. So what you'd expect to see underneath that pot is one of these, and that bites down inside the guitar when you tighten the nut, and it means that you don't get any movement. But we'll have to see if there's one of those there, because at the moment this is just spinning freely, which puts tension on all of these solder joints, and these aren't particularly well done. You can see here we have bridge ground, so that'll go through to the bridge stud on the other side of the guitar, and that'll give your strings your grounding, and that's soldered onto the back of this pot. Then we have a 4 or 5 strand wire coming from the 2 single coil Wilkinson pickups, so you would have the option of some sort of coil tap, even though those pickups are in fact 2 single coils wide in series rather than a traditional humbucker, which will give you that slant. So you can see here, this is the sleeve of this cable, again just soldered to the top of here, and then we have, in, it's not even shrink wrap, this is just electrical tape holding everything together. Let's see if we can't get that off and see what's happening. What we'd hope to see when you take the two single coils and wire them in series, or the 2 coils of a humbucker and wire them in series, you would hope to see the north coil finish and the
south coil start, soldered together, nice and solid, maybe heat shrinked or protected in some way. Let's have a look at what has happened in this guitar. So there you go, that's what you can see. That is a solder joint, but it was just wrapped up with that electrician's tape. And this is a very thin gauge wire, I imagine. I can probably tug that apart. There you go. There's very little holding those two together. And this is the sort of thing that gets brought into me quite a lot. You'll have a cheap guitar, and the whole guitar relies on these two wires being soldered together. If they're not, your guitar's not going to work. You'll either get an extremely buzzy output, or you won't get any output whatsoever. And this is indicative of where they're saving money. Okay, moving on, we'll have a look at these pots in detail later on. Over here we have our capacitor that allows the treble frequencies to bleed to ground through this pot. And here is a coaxial cable going from the volume out to the jack. And I'm assuming that jack over there is going to be quite poor quality. And again, there's no sort of shielding. And what's interesting is you can see how the finish has been applied here. So we have a flake coat that it looks to be gold, and then a colour coat on top, and then obviously on this part of the finish there's going to be a lacquer. So it's interesting that this is going to be, this guitar will have been sanded, it will have been sealed, primed, then it will have had this sparkle metal flake coat, then it will have had this grey colour coat that I'm scraping off now. Let me grab a scalpel and see how that goes. And you can see now I've got through the sparkle, these chips that are coming off here. So I can't get them focused in slightly better. These are a sealer. This is the sealer. This is the thing that you put on a guitar straight after the wood, and that allows you to sand it flat. Much easier than sanding wood flat. Again, we'll look at the finish in more detail later. So I'm going to take these pots out now and we'll see how they are installed. So we do have, on this one, two washers and a compression clampy style washer, and on this one, two washers and a compression clampy style washer. So really, if they'd come from the factory tightened down, they shouldn't have been moving around at all. I'm just going to turn my soldering iron on and we'll take these away. While we're waiting for that to heat up, I'll just do this jack socket.
onto the other end of that coaxial cable from the cavity. Very simple. And that's not the worst jack I've ever come across. That's quite a bit of resistance to flexing. Same here. So we'll take that off when that sort of is heated up. That's our volume, and the tone will come straight with it. And then we should be able to take this jack out, and then we have our bridge ground. And this is from our pickups. Let's look at the pickups next. So these are the Wilkinson branded single coils that are wired in series. And of course we know that all a humbucker is two single coils on the same base plate wired in series with opposite magnetic polarity. So these are direct mounted. I imagine there may or may not be a spring under here. There may or may not be a rubber grommet. Or there could just be some foam. I'll have a look at it in a minute. Already the pickup cover, the plastic that says Wilkinson, feels extremely loose. And that just came off straight away. I'll have a look at this next one. Two plastic covers. And yeah, they, you can hear, I don't know if you can hear, but there's some sort of foam with an adhesive backing that's just holding those in. There you go. And we'll pull that one through. We'll look at those later on. Okay, now you can see. Oh, that's quite a dense foam actually. So inside here there's a dark, dense, spongy foam material that I'll try and get out, but it's going to be glued in pretty well. And whether it's glued in with a contact adhesive or, you know, hot snot, you know, glue gun, who knows? See if we can't get it out. So that looks to just be our contact adhesive. Now that is a very dense rubber. This feels like the sort of stuff that you get on a kid's playground. So when your kid falls off the roundabout and cracks their head, they don't crack their head, they just get a bit of a whack. Have a look inside. So yeah, this is extremely dense, rubbery stuff. You can see how dense the air pockets are inside there. This is not what I was expecting at all. I thought we'd be looking at more of a soft, spongy material that would give you a little bit more adjustability when you tighten these screws down. You get a bit more adjustability, whereas this, there's very little compression to this. It's an interesting choice. It must be cheaper, I imagine. And then let's have a look, see if we can't get inside this. And it looks like there is a smattering, a tiny, tiny, tiny little bit of conductive paint in there, which is strange because the only thing touching that paint was the screws. Yeah, it feels like conductive paint. That's interesting, because that conductive paint is really quite expensive. It didn't have any connection to ground, therefore it was completely useless. Let's see if we can't get these bridge studs out. There's a couple of ways of doing this. If they're badly installed, I might be able to just lever them out with this rotation. So that's quite an aggressive way to do that. So that's your bridge stud. And I'll show you the other method on this one. What happens here is the adjustable part pushes on the screw that's in there as you screw it down, which has nowhere to go. Has to force the stud out. And then you can just recover your screws and your bolts. And then you can might just be able to see inside here, there is that line, and that is the bridge ground. So that is the wire that comes through here. What's that? Let's just have a look at these strap pins, and then we'll be about done with the body. Quite a weedy little screw to be carrying the entire weight of the guitar. You might have noticed if you've ever put strap locks on a guitar, those screws are huge in comparison. They go much deeper because they assume that once you put strap locks on your guitar, you're going to thrash it about a bit more.
And also, you don't want your... The strap lock isn't going to fail. It's a very well-designed thing. But you don't want the wood of the guitar to be ripping out and then you get a load of complaints. Although I have seen that happen and fixed that sort of thing. So there you go. That is the disassembled guitar. It is very light and I'm very interested to see the construction. Just quickly, I want to see, it isn't binding. I mentioned it earlier on, whether it was binding or whether it was paint. And you can see just here, that is, oh no, my mistake, it is binding. That is plastic binding. So that's quite kind of interesting. That's another process, rather than just giving it to your paint guy to mask off. It's another process of either on the CNC or the router table. And then gluing up a binding is quite a time consuming job, especially in a corner like here. That's quite a sharp corner. I'm rather surprised that that's a real binding. Very interesting. So if you can see here, this dark line, they've taken rosewood dust from where they've shaped the fingerboard. They'll have bags of the stuff available. And then packed it with super glue or a wood glue into the fret slot. So the fret tang will be cut off on the end here. And it will extend, it won't extend out of the fretboard here. And you can see where they packed it with rosewood dust. Okay, let's have a look at this truss rod. So we have this tiny truss rod cover, and inside . So sometimes I've seen absolute nightmares in these truss rod covers where things haven't been masked at all and you've just got a build-up of gunk in there. I've also seen it where it's been masked and then you go in there and you pull out the masking tape that hasn't been used, that hasn't been removed. And that truss rod actually looks quite chewed up, which is interesting. So I don't know if you can see inside there. Already looks as if it's been chewed up and played with, and it's quite hard to access because of the angle that it's been put in. We've already looked at the bottom of the tank. Let's have a look at these tuners. Wilkinson stamps on them, which is a good sign. I mean, Wilkinson are quite an affordable company, but they do produce some okay stuff. Sometimes on these cheaper, more affordable guitars, when they've installed these machine heads, they've just been mullered. They've really been, you know, you see they have these big air-powered screwdrivers that they use for everything, with torque settings in there, you know, the manual to how to construct the guitar, you know, because they got this minimal training, and they do the same thing over and over again. So it'll be one guy's job just to screw these in. And he'll have hanging down a big screwdriver that has a torque setting that he'll set from his manual on how much torque to put onto these tiny screws, these little things. And if, you know, when he starts his shift, he's having a bad day,
might have put those in wrong. Goes at it really far too hard and chowders up the screw head. But not on this guitar, so that's pretty good. Oh, that sounds quite tight. I heard a crack there as I was undoing it, which could be the paint. Again. So, I don't know if you can hear this. I'll see if I can do it from this angle. I've had to put a lot of effort into turning this. Crack. Crack. Now, I think that's going to be the paint underneath the tuner bushing. Because again, Dude will have another hanging down air spanner set to put these on, and you can see all of the paint around that washer has been compressed, and there's a big old circle where the washer was sitting, where it's been, they've been tightened too much, and there's absolutely no need for them to be that tight. Yeah, just a little tighter than finger tight would have been absolutely fine, because they've got the screw on the back that'll do the job. Okay, again, we'll look at those tuners later on. Now, I want to see if I can catch this for you. As I move this light, you can see the outline of the decal on Zip, which is interesting, whereas on the Vintage, you can't. Now, a well-installed decal, you shouldn't be able to see. Can't see anything like that. You shouldn't be able to see that outline. You can see just here, that outline. You get all of this. And can you see just here, something called orange peel, and that's down to the speed that they have to churn these guitars out. There just isn't time to put enough coats on here and flat sand and nerf coats and flat sand, coat again, flat sand, to really bury this. And you can actually feel that decal. And what's interesting is the decal has a, you can see it changing in the light. So it's got a kind of pearl effect, kind of holographic-y. And I think that's to, I don't know, maybe tie in with this, but they are, it doesn't look like it there, but they are completely different finishes. This, I think, could be an inlay, but we'll find that out as well. So we have this, and the headstock looks like, you know, they've made it look like it could be bound. You know, if it wasn't bound, that'd just be an ebony faceplate. Again, this guy is paint. But is it bound? Is it not bound? Interesting to find out. What you'll find often is inside here, it's like a white buildup. And that's from flat sanding. And that's from sanding paint. And when you're sanding here, it goes inside and just dries out, all the moisture goes away. And then you get this buildup. And you see it a lot on Epiphones. And you see it on, I've seen it on Schecters and bits and pieces like that, where they spend a bit of time, you know, flat sanding. This guy, there's very little buildup, and that's because they haven't flat sanded very much at all. Again, it might not be visible on camera, but yeah, so you can kind of, you might not be able to see this with YouTube compression. As I move the light over this section, you can see it kind of divots in, and over here there is a lot of little light, tiny lines. That's down to the speed that they have to finish this thing. Fretboard's okay, nice and straight. Nice straight grain on the rosewood. Frets look nice. I might pull one of these frets later on and see see what the install is like. And then what we'll do is I'll flatten the neck, and then we can see if there are any high frets, and I'll do a fret one map.
So there we have it. That is the vintage Zip. Every part completely disassembled. I'll take the nut off and have a look at the truss rod separately. And I think in the next video we'll either do hardware and we'll look at the quality of some of the screws and fixings and the hardware, or we will look at the electronics. If you stick a comment saying what you'd like to see next, that'd help me decide, because I'm not decided yet. If you like the video, press like, that'd be really cool. Let me know that what I'm doing is interesting. If you'd like to see more videos like this, subscribe to the channel and share with your friends that might be interested. But that's all for today. Hope you enjoyed it, and I shall catch you next time. Bye-bye.